Welcome everyone to our first session of the day. We are zooming in from all different time zones, and I think that's represented even across the moderation and the presenters. We've got an exciting conversation with a lot of good energy around this understanding of diversity, cultural respect, and also hospitality and religious education. We have four presenters this morning and three presentations. The way that we are going to set about our presentations today is that each presenter is going to go, then we'll have about 7 minutes for collective conversation around that presentation. Then after all three presenters have presented, we'll have a collective conversation about all three presentations together, where I'll also invite the presenters to join in on that conversation as well. And then we will close out with an announcement about our evaluations. So the first presenter is going to be Heejin Choi. Heejin Choi has completed her PhD program at the University of Toronto in May. And currently she works as the pastor and director of ministry with infants and young parents at Macheon Taegyeo Church in South Korea. She serves as an adjunct professor at the Presbyterian University and Theological Seminary in Korea. And her presentation today is called Towards a Pedagogy of Just Hospitality, a Theo-Ethical Proposal for Ministry with Children of Different Cultures. Welcome, Heejin.
Thank you, Dr. Hong. And hello, everyone. It's an honor for me to present something that I have researched in this meeting. So now I'll share my screen with you all. The topic I'd like to talk about today is a possibility of pedagogy of just hospitality in relation to culturally different children in a multicultural society. Sadly, in a multicultural society, racism is not only a matter of adults, but also that of little children. Here is a vignette, which I quoted from the book, The First R, written by Deborah Van Ostale and Jill Fijan, who observed power dynamics among culturally different children in a daycare in the US. During playtime in the afternoon, we watch Rini pulling Mai and Jocelyn across the playground in a wagon. Rini tugs away enthusiastically, but the task is difficult. Pulling this heavy load across loose dirt is more than Rini can handle. Suddenly, she drops the handle, which falls to the ground and stands still, breathing heavily. Ling Mai, eager to continue this game, jumps from the wagon and picks up the handle. As Ling Mai begins to pull, Rini admonishes her. No, no, you can't pull this wagon. Only white Americans can pull this wagon. Rini has her hands on her hips and frowns at Ling Mai. The Asian girl tries again. To leave the handle of the wagon, and Rini again instead, only Americans are permitted to do this task. This is not a single incident. Many other disturbing incidents are reported in the book and other platforms, test papers, and the stop children from different cultures. All perceive themselves as holding different levels of power in their social settings. Children of color often experience marginalization or exclusion, and they are often framed as vulnerable and marginalized strangers within their own communities. In this poignant situation, what kind of pedagogy is needed for our children's ministry? I find a possibility from Jesus' welcoming of children into the kingdom of God. Welcoming is a practice of hospitality, and hospitality is a biblical tradition that is central to the Christian faith community throughout the history. From this point, I aim to analyze Christian hospitality and add a more critical understanding to the concept of Christian hospitality And furthermore, I hope to envision a pedagogy of just hospitality that can be reflected in children's ministry in a multicultural society. Regarding Christian hospitality, early Christians are particularly noteworthy. Their practice of hospitality was praised in their wider society and also has served as an exemplary model of Christian hospitality for today's church. One reason for this praise is that early Christians practiced hospitality without expecting reciprocity. This feature was deeply rooted in biblical teachings. Here are two examples of such teachings. In the First Testament, ancient Israelites were required to extend hospitality to strangers and sojourners based on their own experience of being strangers in Egypt. Early Christians also embraced this imperative because of their marginalized status in the Roman Empire. Early Christians identified themselves with exiles and refugees. Therefore, they practiced hospitality by sheltering strangers and harboring other Christian asylum seekers. Next, in the Second Testament, Jesus taught people to be hospitable to the vulnerable. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus told a parable that he distinguished between righteous sheep and unrighteous goats. This separation is based on how they treated the least, like those who were hungry, thirsty, strangers, naked, sick, or in prison. Jesus identifies himself with the least and calls those righteous who treated well one of the least. This passage became a recurring theme throughout the early Christian texts on hospitality. Accordingly, early Christian communities extended their hospitality to those who were most vulnerable and least able to reciprocate. However, the hospitality practice of early Christians had a problematic aspect, which Il-Sapon calls the paradigm of gift. In this paradigm, hosts believe that they have abundant resources to give strangers or guests. This form of hospitality is unidirectional, with the primary focus on meeting the physical needs of strangers and guests. However, in today's context, where justice and equality are emphasized in intercultural relationships with power imbalances, the traditional gift paradigm may be seen as paternalistic. If the gift paradigm of hospitality is applied to our intercultural settings with power differentials, dominant people assume the role of hosts and givers, while marginalized people are easily framed as guests and receivers. This giver-receiver relationship perpetuates inequality within the relationship. Therefore, a more just understanding of hospitality is needed in our intercultural context. Some theologians propose a more just understanding of hospitality. First, Letty Russell emphasizes the relational aspect of hospitality, shifting the focus of Christian hospitality from gift-giving in a traditional sense to a relational understanding. She relates the justice issue in human relationships to Christian hospitality and calls it just hospitality. She defines just hospitality as the practice of God's welcome by reaching out across difference to participate in God's actions, bringing justice and healing in our world of crisis and fear of the one we call other. Her definition emphasizes two crucial issues. First, the fear of those who are labeled as other, and second, the significance of reaching out across difference. According to her, dominant people perceive marginalized individuals as the other, considering themselves as the norm or standard. The marginalized are seen as divergent from this norm and permanently different from the dominant. This perceived persistent difference generates fear and leads to the oppression of the marginalized. Russell contends that difference should be named not by the dominant, but by the marginalized with their own voices and their own agencies. When this emancipatory potential of difference is acknowledged by all culturally different people, difference can be seen not as a threat, but as a gift. Based on this positive and emancipatory understanding of difference, Russell claims that just hospitality fosters communication and partnership across all differences within the hospitality relationship with the aim of pursuing justice within an unjust reality. Indeed, Russell puts forth a vision of Christian hospitality that goes beyond the traditional paradigm of gift. However, in her exploration of just hospitality, she employs the binary of us and them. Whether intentionally or not, this binary division represents a hermeneutical violence that defines the marginalized as strangers or guests within the context of hospitality. Kian Choi's argument offers a pathway to achieve epistemic justice in terms of hospitality. She provides a more accurate understanding of people of color in the North American context, challenging the unjust framing of them as mere strangers or guests. People of color learn new languages and understand, adopt, resist, or integrate norms and rules upheld in North America. They have endured these challenging practices to support their well-being as residents in society. Choi confronts the binary of host-guest, highlighting the complex experiences of people of color and their transition from foreigners and guests to residents. Choi boldly states that people of color want to be co-hosts in this land by all means. They are co-hosts after all. For Choi, sharing the co-hostship is crucial in a relationship of hospitality. Becoming co-hosts means becoming co-guests to one another and, in a sense, belonging to one another in a hospitality relationship. The discussions of Russell and Choi have shed light on key aspects of a more just hospitality. First, it involves crossing the boundaries that distinguish between culturally different people with varying levels of power. Second, it requires acknowledging and embracing the shared co-hostship among all participants in a hospitality relationship, recognizing their interconnectedness and belongingness to one another. Last, it entails partnering with one another to actively resist social injustice. I firmly believe that these three principles, which embody the ethos of just hospitality, should be reflected in children's ministry within the Christian faith community. To make this possible, I envision a pedagogy of just hospitality. Here, I suggest its several principles. The first principle is reframing the adult-child relationship as co-hosts and co-guests. It's crucial to create an environment where adults and children share the co-hostship and recognize their belongingness to one another. This reframing requires a hermeneutic shift in understanding children as full human beings rather than human becomings on the path to adulthood. This understanding forms the foundation for just hospitality in the faith community. It includes valuing children's unique perspectives, insights, and spiritual journeys. It also involves listening to children's voices and providing opportunities for meaningful engagement within the faith community, such as involving children in decision-making processes. In this way, children's presence can become more integral to the communal life of the faith community. The principle of sharing co-hostship between adults and children should be accompanied by educating culturally different children as agents of just hospitality in their intercultural relationships. This can be achieved when children of different cultures form genuine friendships with equal power or co-hostship in their relationships. In order to establish the friendship with just hospitality, the ethos of just hospitality needs to permeate all aspects of children's ministry, including worship services, Bible study, small group gatherings, and play. For example, worship services can intentionally represent cultural diversity and differences through imagery of children of different cultural backgrounds and portrayals of Jesus as a person of color. Another method is the use of bibliodrama in a Bible study. It allows children to engage with biblical narratives, interpreting the narratives from their own cultural perspectives and collaborating with peers from other cultural backgrounds, which can promote mutual learning and understanding. More direct instruction can be incorporated through open dialogue on social issues in small group gatherings, addressing power imbalances in intercultural relationships. In addition, play can serve as a space for children to actively participate as moral agents and challenge biases and stereotypes against children of color. These activities in the faith community can enable all culturally different children to learn the ethos of just hospitality directly or indirectly, and empower the children to embody it in their daily lives, particularly in their intercultural interactions with peers from different cultural backgrounds. Revisiting the passage mentioned in the introduction, Jesus' words, "The kingdom of God belongs to such as these children," hold significance in today's context of power imbalances among culturally different children. It signifies that the kingdom of God welcomes all culturally different children unconditionally and encourages their co-hostship. In response to Jesus' call, the faith community should actively practice just hospitality in the company of culturally different children by embodying and exemplifying the values of friendship, justice, and hospitality. The faith community ought to empower culturally different children to transcend power dynamics and collaborate towards realizing the vision of God's kingdom on earth. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Heejin, for your wonderful presentation. I want to open the conversation up to everybody in the room to offer comments or insights or questions about Heejin's presentation at this time. And we'll have this conversation for about 7 minutes. You can go ahead and just raise your hand or unmute and join in.
So I have a question, and agree with just about everything you said. Chuck, go ahead.
Thank you, and good morning, or good evening, wherever people are at. I didn't want to interrupt you, Tom, but a couple of thoughts came to mind. Most recently, obviously, we're dealing here in the United States with the asylum seekers seeking safety here. And so that model of hospitality you're talking about, you know, is very much applying to the status of people here in New York. We have a group, mostly young parents and children, ages 1 to 5 at a Ramada Inn that have been placed here as my new neighbors. And so we're trying to provide, you know, whatever hospitality, and that limitations, the dominance is something to think about, but also just the absolute necessity to provide basics for the newly arrived neighbors. And Johann Baptist Metz made the point of, as people are coming into the country, sometimes maybe not having all the resources or running out of resources by being overwhelmed as much as we want to help, number one. And number two, trying to trying to investigate the problem that's happening in the countries of origin. And right now, some of those problems are climate change and war and violence and dictators and oppression. So that's something also to explore as people are coming to our shores under these circumstances. And then the final thing is a study that was done that revealed when children read books that involve people of different cultures, when white children read books that included Black children in the books, they found that the white children played with the Black children in the playground. And that when white children only read white books, books about white children, they did not play with the Black children in the playground. And so I think that's a fantastic study to show the importance of intercultural learning, intercultural reading, exposure to other cultures, because that study alone showed the importance of children learning about diversity in books and not having those books banned or having those books taken away from them by law or Board of Ed rules. So, but thank you very much. I really enjoyed the reciprocity of guest hosts. That also occurs within interreligious prayer services, which I have been planning in terms of who's involved and how the guest host relationship takes place in interreligious prayer services when the world religions are brought together to pray. Thank you.
Thank you, Chuck. Tom, did you want to jump in? And then also there's a question here in the chat that I wanted to lift up as well.
I'll try to be quick because I think Chuck kind of hit on part of what I was going to say, actually. Agree with so much of what you presented there. If I brought this to a children's ministry where I am in the United States and said, hey, we need to be thinking more along these lines, the first thing that some parent would say is, well, you're being woke. You're being, you know, you're pushing these ideas on our children and you're trying to get us to do certain things. And again, Chuck referenced the idea of banning books. This is a huge problem. So how do we, I guess the question is, and this is kind of for anybody, how do we sell that idea? Or how do we perpetuate this idea, I guess would be better than sell, to people who are just really unreceptive? And I think in the States right now, in a lot of places, people are very unreceptive to the idea that hospitality, the way you're describing it and the way you're talking about it, is actually, they're questioning whether or not it's a biblical principle.
Thanks, Tom. Heejin, I want to lift up a question in the chat, and then maybe if there's a couple minutes for you to address anything that you'd like to address that you've heard from here. So Karen Marie has typed, would you please say more about how co-hosting might look in the practical activities of a Sunday school? So I think that that's also a really good question that gives you space to provide an example. So you've got three different comments and questions in the room.
So to respond to Dr. Yust, I thought that I shared some practical activities of a Sunday school through my paper, but to say more about that, I will say that biblical drama can be a great tool for children to participate in the small group gatherings when interpreting the biblical narratives from their own cultural perspectives. Because, you know, the basic pursuit of biblical drama is that opening the possible interpretation of the biblical narrative to all participants without a specific or particular, you know, anticipation of the teacher or Christian educator's guidance. So that can be a way for to encourage the learner or or little children to freely interpret the biblical story, and also they can, you know, fill in the blank that is found between the, you know, sentences or biblical lines in the passage that we cannot see. So I think that can be a practical activity of a Sunday school. I hope this can be an answer for your question.
Thank you, Heejin. We're going to move on to the next presentation, but I hope to that we can engage your work alongside the work of our other colleagues in our summative conversation at the end. The next presenter that we have this morning, afternoon, evening is Ina Terevest, who is Professor Emeritus in Interreligious Education. She dedicated her research and publications on related issues like hybrid identity development, and her presentation today focuses on the history or the biography of the development of a model of interreligious education in the Netherlands, and it is entitled Hospitable Education. Ina, go ahead. Thank you and welcome to the room.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your nice introduction. I'll try to share screen with you. I hope it works. Can you see my screen? Okay, fine. Well, in the past, in the Netherlands took the form of a pillarized society with three pillars, Catholic, Protestant, and liberal, living apart together. And each pillar came with its own education system, its own schools, its own healthcare, its own newspapers. And in the 80s, a fourth pillar was added to this, this construction, an Islamic pillar. The innovative process of what has been coined as interreligious education began at the request of Muslim parents in the 80s, in the latter days of the Dutch pillarized society. Muslim children, so-called guest workers, were enrolled in public and Christian primary schools. Muslim parents, who were familiar with the constitutional freedom of religion and education in the Netherlands, inquired about the possibility of Islamic religious education during school hours at a Christian primary school, similar to Christian religious education already provided during school hours. In a small town in the Dutch Bible Belt, in a district populated by Orthodox Protestant Christians, this request from Muslim parents touched upon the life orientation of a primary school principal and his conviction that religious education was an important aspect of pupils' identity development, regardless of whether they are Christians or Muslims. In the complexity of providing religious education for Muslim pupils in a Christian school, Principal Bart ten Broek responded to the question, "Why are you the leader?" with the Bible text read at his own confirmation, "You shall be my witness." At the same time, he recognized that he was a witness in a different way than the priest had in mind during the confirmation ceremony. And even in that different way, however, his focus was on a personal, individual leadership. In his childhood, Principal Bart ten Broek lived in the countryside in a village characterized by a conservative Christian climate. This was also true of his family. He remembers the grade six teacher telling stories during the church services about missionaries in Indonesia and New Guinea. This triggered in Bart a wish to become a missionary himself. He still recalls this text from the Bible that was read as his confirmation, "You shall be my witness," with a focus on the person, "You shall be my witness." And years later, Bart regards this text as an inspiration for his innovative concretization of interreligious education at the Juliana van Stolberg Primary School. Although, he articulates, although in a different way than the priest had in mind at that moment. Over the years, the Bible text got a different, a deeper meaning for him. Principal Bart developed a strong conviction that the context in which children live is very important. In his view, every child enters the school with their parents' religious or secular value orientation in their backpack. And for Bart, this resulted in a decision to dedicate his life to giving full attention to each child in context. And the slogan of his school became, "Every child matters." The innovative process launched at the then unknown context of a Christian school with Muslim pupils began as an elaboration of intercultural education with a focus on encounter and dialogue. The aim was to create moments of encounter to enable pupils to become familiar with the other and the other's cultural and religious background. A mixture of teaching and learning about and teaching and learning from and with the other, a reciprocal process. Teaching and learning about refers to knowledge of religious rituals and their meaning for classmates. For examples, pupils got to know about family rituals of fasting during the months of Ramadan and what this fasting meant for classmates and their family. Teaching and learning from and with refers to the reflection that begins in the moments when pupils become acquainted with something new, moments of wonder, moments of amazement. Pupils begin and are stimulated to reflect upon the meaning of such new information, which they then try to connect with what they know already or wish to create new knowledge in mutual dialogue. We know that for a successful dialogue to take place, knowledge of and experience with different styles of communication is preconditional. A hermeneutic communicative style facilitates the understanding of the meaning of religious phenomena for the persons involved, as informed by knowledge about religion in question. In this school's case, cognitive and experiential knowledge came together in an understanding of the meaning of religion for faithful Christians and Muslims. In addition to styles of communication, there is a distinction between dimensions of communication. In relation to the cognitive and emotional age of the children, it is recommended to pay attention to, in religious education classes, to a semiotic dimension relating to signs and their meanings, for example, the sign of fasting and its meaning for Muslims and Christians. The institutional dimension concerning general official statements by institutions on the one hand, for example, the Sunni tradition, and individual statements of the other, of a person, of what he or she individually thinks and believes. And a linguistic dimension regarding literal and metaphorical understanding of religious text. The pedagogic civil society, whose children are they, or who is responsible for religious education for the next generation? The school's pedagogical task and the parents' double responsibility come together in the pedagogic civil society. Different activities can be implemented to establish a fruitful school-home contact. Teachers and parents can stay in touch about school affairs, or parents can help their children to do their homework, or they can be invited to assist with school activities on a voluntary basis, or parents and teachers can participate together in activities organized in the school's neighborhood. In each of these activities, teachers and parents act on an equal footing as partners in education, a shared leadership, and a shared responsibility in the education of the children, a kind of a circle process. Most of the time, however, teachers take the initiative for parent participation in school activities. Parents must, of course, be able or enabled to meet the question of teachers. For constructive teacher-parent contacts, teachers must become familiar with the parents' cultural and religious backgrounds. a certain modesty on the part of the teachers regarding their own professional contribution will positively influence the relation with the parents. Teachers should never forget that parents are the first responsible persons for the education of their children. Parental contribution flourishes the moment teachers show their genuine interest in parents' view on education, and when they invite parents to bring their ideas on education to the table. Parents and teacher. The question is how they, in togetherness, share their responsibility for the tradition, that is the ongoing process of narrating and practicing traditions. Teachers and parents bear joint responsibility for the education of the child. The Convention on the Rights of the Child states that education must prepare pupils for an active life in a free society and should be inspired by and directed towards the development of respect for their parents, respect for the culture they live in, they were born in, as well as respect for the cultural background of others. The Convention on the Rights of the Child deals with the responsibility of parents as being primarily responsible for the upbringing and development of their children, in line with their own religious or secular life orientation. In addition, according to the Convention of the Rights of the Child, parents also have a duty to create spaces for their children where they can come into contact with different ways of living. For parents, this constitutes a double task of holding on to their own tradition and letting go in a plural society. Respect for the other's otherness is a key concept in this and is at the heart of democracy. Hospitality, as we heard already in the first presentation, hospitality is a core concept, not only in the Christian, but also in the Islamic tradition. Opening the doors of your house, opening your mind for the other without requiring something to be done in return, that is hospitality. Receiving the other in my house presupposes that I feel at home in my own house. And that's exactly why Muslim parents asked about the possibility for their children to receive Islamic religious education in a Christian school to make their children feel at home in the Islamic tradition, in the way Christian children feel at home in their Christian tradition. The teachers of this Christian Juliana van Stolberg Primary School, experts in education, hosted the children's parents, the children's caretakers, in the world of education, as they hosted the children in their roles of pupils and of classmates. Parents were welcomed as guests in the house of the Christian Juliana van Stolberg Primary School and consequently felt at home there. The other way around, parents, expert in the loving caretaking of their children, also hosted the teachers, literally by inviting them for a visit at their homes and metaphorically by telling them stories about their children in their family roles as sons and daughters of and brothers or sisters of. In this way, teachers came to feel at home in their pupils' families. Hospitable education, a mutual process, a flexible process of changing positions of being guest and being host. Each and every child should be given the opportunity to host the other, to name differences, to explore in a dialogical space in what way and to what extent the strange can become familiar, and to feel at ease in their religious home as part of their own identity in process. Each and every child should be offered the opportunity to be a guest and feel at home in the other's house. That is what hospitable education is about. However, like building a house requires bricks and technical instruments, in a similar way, hospitable education requires its building blocks, learning with and from the other, feeling at home in the religious house of oneself and the other. And in that process, in my view, the technical instruments of dialogicality must not be neglected. Dialogicality, scaffolding the required safe place for hospitality. Thank you.
Thank you, Ina, for that wonderful presentation. I'd like to invite everyone in the room to offer comments or insights or ask questions at this time. Ina, do you think you could stop sharing your screen? Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Let me see. Go ahead and unmute. I can't see all of the hands that are coming up. Let me see. Paula, I see your hand.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Christine Hong, and thank you for the presentation from Dr. Ina. I agree with your presentation, and I learned many things in your presentation. But I won't go deeper or go ahead about your statement in your paper, especially when you tell to us about this hospitality can be held when we meet strangers and invite the strangers to meet us and understanding our activities or our knowledge or our house or our home, like your paper in page, especially from page paper three. And when we held about the situation in children, there are many parents say to the children, told to them like, don't invite strangers into our house because they are not our family or they are not our friends, so you can be stolen. In this situation, I think that when we invite strangers in our home and can learn together in this situation, I think adults is okay, but in children, I think it's tricky, right? Especially in this situation. And when how it correlates in your paper, especially from page three until page four, when you propose about pedagogic of civil society. And I think that pedagogic civil society in these papers, especially tell to us that there is no trauma, there is no conflict, there is no children stolen or some problem in children. So what it can be solved when you propose about pedagogic civil society in this situation? Thank you.
Thank you, Paulus. Ina, did you want to respond to that?
Yes, please. Well, I think you really touch upon a very important aspect of my presentation, that it's very much colored by the local situation in the Netherlands, where in general, we can easily open our house literally and invite strangers to come to our house, have dinner with us and have nice conversations. But I think what I refer to is not only the literal interpretation of house or home, but also the metaphorical interpretation. So I also want to point to be as persons opening up to others, showing what is very important for us, but also being very curious in a very authentic way to ask the other about meanings in his or her life orientation. So there is a difference between a literal and a metaphorical understanding. But you really, it's very important what you state at first. Our society so far is safe and we can open our houses for the other. Yeah. And that means that this concept of pedagogic civil society is really kind of maybe even a Dutch concept, where it's very easy to get in touch with all the people involved living in the neighborhood of a school and trying to bring people together, because children are not only educated in the family and at school, but also at the sports club and at the whatever, playing in the street and so on. So it's kind of bringing all people together And that's possible in our open society. Yes, and that's I become aware of the luxurious position I have in this situation. Thank you for making me aware of that. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
We have about 3 minutes left. Do you hear any other comments or questions for Ina? There's still a hand up here. There's a comment. Oh, Sola has said, let's see here. Sola has asked a question in the chat. What are instances where hospitality is abused? In my context, children have seen over and over how their parents' hospitality is abused and the tenant becomes the landlord. How can we help them still trust enough to be hospitable, having been once beaten, twice shy? There's also another question from Sola here. The idea of being at home in the house of the other is one. It is really practical that a child will feel at home in the home. At home in the home of one that has a different faith belief, the rituals, practices would not likely make them feel at home. How do you help children in this kind of tension if they and the host do not pretend? Ina, is there something there that you'd like to respond to?
I mean, in the case of child abuse and the abuse of hospitality, I'm just flabbergasted, you know, I just have no answer. In the case of mm-hmm. children being in situations of tension, for example, when a Christian child goes to play with a Muslim child and has to put off his shoes at the house and he's not used to that, I would like teachers and parents to learn their children that it's not uncomfortable to ask a question, just to ask, why do I have to put my shoes off? And that the other does not feel uncomfortable to explain. I think in general, I can say in the Netherlands, we are kind of a bit afraid of asking this kind of question because it's too personal. But that, I mean, that would help a lot.
Thank you so much. Elizabeth,
I'm a bit flabbergasted at the sense of the distrust. For me, the whole notion is that children are curious, and as you would prepare children to go into a situation that is different from them, surely part of the teacher's role is to encourage the children with what kind of questions they might ask. And I'm continuing on, Ina, what you were saying. But the whole notion of I like you, you're different. Children are really interested in the variety and the differences, and helping them to appreciate. I guess for me, one of my basic cultural understandings was a picture in the Sunday school hall that was of Jesus with children all dressed up from all around the world. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, black and yellow, red and white, all are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Now that was ingrained in my thinking as a young child, growing up in Papua New Guinea as a minority white in a majority Papuan community. And I think that sense of trying to help children understand that they are part of a global community, I find it really strange that we don't think that everyone is part of a global community and people are different. Why aren't we helping our children to explore the different religious traditions of others and doing that with respect? I think it's, you know, some of the core values that we would want to say as religious educators are of respect, and that is really important. And in our, maybe in, I'm sorry, the United States, and in parts of the world, yes, we are. So isolationist, perhaps. And I'm glad that there are some countries like Holland and some of us. Australia isn't wonderful, but at least we call ourselves a multicultural society and multi-faith. So I think that's, for me, what this Religious Education Association's been on about since I joined in 1983.
Thank you, Elizabeth. I think that's a wonderful question to start for our collective conversation about all three papers. I'm going to bring that back around, Elizabeth, if you don't mind. We are going to move on to our third presentation, where we have two speakers for this presentation. Thank you, Ina, for your wonderful presentation again. Our next presenters are Dr. Sarah Holmes, who's a lecturer in early childhood at Liverpool Hope University. Her area of research is children's faith and specifically navigating how this can be supported by the family, church, and the school. Along with Sarah is Dr. Harriet Pattison, who is a senior lecturer in early childhood at Liverpool Hope University. Her academic background is in social anthropology and philosophy. Her area of special research interest is alternative education and education outside school, and she has conducted research with both Muslim and Christian home educators. Their presentation is called Religious Rights and Religious Freedom: How Do We Set the Agenda for Christian Education? Welcome, Sarah and Harriet.
Thank you. Thank you. So hopefully you can see our slides on the screen there. If you could pop the next slide on, Harriet. So to give you a bit of a flavour of our project, we saw the title of this conference about whose children are they, and it seemed to fit really well with our research, because we were approached previously by the Christian Home Educating Support Service, who were very concerned about a schools bill that Parliament was proposing here in England last year. And the concerns were surrounding the overbearing nature and the overreach of power, as some were saying. And there was a real fear and worry amongst the Christian home educating community here that there would be limitations very much put onto them as Christian home educators. And so we were asked to get involved with this research, which we were delighted to do. And we were fascinated to have 462 responses showing the strength of feeling. I think the survey was open for about a month. So we were able to have that, which is really interesting. So in the UK, we have a bit, not as much research around Christian home education as perhaps in other parts of the world. So this really fed into a gap that we saw. So I'll hand over to Harriet to provide a bit of the theoretical background.
Sorry, I'm having problems with my order of, sorry, yeah, hopefully I'll get it right from here on in. Yes, so we had this data, we had this question from the Christian home educators, and we had a lot of data, a lot of input from them. And in order to kind of theorize that and get a handle on it, we've been using Will Kimlicker's thoughts on minority groups within pluralistic societies. And Kimlicker's got two lines of concern when he's considering the position of these groups. And the first of these is the extent to which they require external protection within the majority group. So he says, if you've got a minority group that is in danger of being overrun, subsumed, marginalized, have its beliefs, values, ways of life threatened by its position within the majority society, then that group is in need of some kind of external protection from the mainstream society in which it exists. So Kimlicker's talking about cultural groups. He doesn't really talk about religious groups, and he has been critiqued for that. And obviously there is a crossover between the religious and the cultural. And perhaps it sharpens up really the position of religious groups within society, because as the quote from Eamon Callan points out there, it's not just about the way that educational decisions about children in families of faith are made. It's also about the parents' rights to enact their faith in the bringing up and the education of their children. So we've got that concern about external protection and what happens to minority groups. When I say a minority group, in actual fact, the last poll last year, a poll of the English population for the first time placed those who identified as Christian in a minority, just under the 50%. This is a minority group within that now minority group of people who have chosen to home educate their children because of their faith. Kimnica's other concern is to do with internal restrictions. Now, this runs alongside his concerns about external protection, but they don't, one doesn't necessarily lead to the other. It's possible for these things to be happening independently, and he is quite clear on that. When he talks about internal restrictions, he's talking about the way in which the collective may impose particular practices, values, ideas, behaviors, restrictions on its members, which would not apply in wider society. So some of his examples are things like arranged marriages or sanctioned domestic violence within minority groups, where there is a clear difference between those practices and the restrictions that they might place on individuals and the freedoms that would be enjoyed and the choices that would be enjoyed in the wider society. So his concern there is to say that it must be made clear within society that these internal restrictions cannot be imposed on people. So if somebody is a member, an individual member of one of these minority groups, and they do not agree with the practices, there must be clear ways for them to challenge those practices and, if necessary, to exit the group. So there's twin considerations there that we wanted to use about the identification of a group in need of external protection and what we do about considering whether there are any internal restrictions that pertain to that group. So I'll go back to Sarah.
This slide shows some of the findings when we heard from these Christian home educators. Some of the questions and responses were multiple choice like these, and others were qualitative, and many of the participants gave huge, great big long narrative in their answers. So fascinating to read. But we see on the pie chart on the left, when they were asked how much of a part did faith play in choosing to be a home educator, we see there that 75% of these participants were choosing deliberately because of their faith, opposed to others who might be selecting home education for reasons of special educational needs or situation or family circumstance or other things. So it was a significant proportion of this group were intentionally choosing to home educate because of their faith. And then on the right-hand side, we asked there, how do you think Christian home educators are viewed by wider society? And it was very clear that over half of these participants said negatively. Only 5% thought that they were viewed positively by wider society. And many of the narrative responses expanded upon this, and we'll touch on that in a moment. The final graph at the bottom there were the responses of how do you think the schools bill, so this is the bill of parliament that was proposed at the time, how will it affect Christian home education? And we see there that 82% of the participants were saying it would be detrimental. And so this was a significant issue at the time for us to really unpack that this policy that was proposed, being imposed within England, would be detrimental, it was perceived, to these Christian home educators. So I'll show you on the next slide some of the discourses that we were seeing in the narrative responses, some of the sense of feeling that was coming through. Firstly, a minority group. Many of these participants were talking about how faith was their driving force to home educate, but actually they felt marginalized now because of this. There was lots of language about being excluded or ostracized from wider society. We also asked how they felt in their church situation. Did they feel included? And many were talking about, again, feeling marginalized within Christian society also. Some told us wonderful stories about feeling included and supported and valued, which was great to hear. But significant numbers were talking about feeling marginalized and a lot of language about feeling sad or disappointed about this, because the clear message coming through was that these parents were choosing to home educate their child so that they could, in their view, carry out biblical instruction, biblical mandates to take responsibility for their child, has been alluded, which was alluded to in one of the previous presentations just now. And so there was a sense that home educators wanted to be active participants in their child's education, but that actually this schools bill being proposed by Parliament was counter to that. Some of the words that people were saying, they felt they'd been called odd or weirdos or strange, they were frowned upon. They weren't giving specific examples, but they have this strong sense of feeling that. And then politicization, many were very strongly conveying about people think we're radical, we're extreme. Some were even saying that they feel Christian home educators are viewed as dangerous or unsafe to be around. And this caused a great deal of upset and hurt amongst the participants. There was a sense that people viewed them as being narrow-minded or intolerant, which is interesting, hearing a lot of what some of the previous presenters have talked about hospitality and accommodation in their theology. Being misunderstood was a strong, strong discourse in the narrative responses. These parents felt they were misrepresented, misreported, portrayed badly in the media or in other places where they're talked about. And this led to a great deal of frustration and disappointment. And they were trying hard to explain the reason why we're wanting to do this is to carry out the biblical instruction. Our theology of family is that we are ultimately responsible, but that the schools bill and these negative portrayals of Christian home educators were trying to deny them the rights to carry out their religious and faith beliefs. And this led on then to look at this thing of who is responsible, the parents or the state, and specifically looking at the schools bill and all of these theological underpinnings and ideas, that this idea of parents training a child the way they should go, and what does that mean? What does that look like? So I'll hand back to Harriet now to bring this back to Kimlicka's theory and how we analyse these various discourses.
So we felt that we had grounds there for arguing the need for external protection for this particular group of people, and we felt that there was a fairly clear-cut argument to carry that trajectory forwards. So I'm going to turn now for our last 5 minutes and just talk about the question about internal restrictions, this being a charge which has been levied against Christian home educators in the United States by people like Catherine Ross and Elizabeth Bartolet, saying that this is a restrictive way of life that indoctrinates children, doesn't allow them proper contact with wider stream society. And indeed, there is a prevailing view. I've got a quote in there from Helen Penn that I think kind of sums up pretty much a prevailing view in England at the moment, that education is something which should be properly secular. And if people want to follow a faith, that's something that they do in their private lives, but it's not something that should be underpinning a state education. And as Sarah's explaining about the schools bill, this isn't an effort to bring home education or privately arranged education in line with what happens in school. So this is why the Christian parents felt that it was a direct threat to them. And they were coming back to us with very different ideas about what it means to follow a faith than the idea that's kind of encapsulated in Penn's quote there, that a faith is something that you can carry out in your private time, but you can put it aside while you're going about your public business. And the parents were saying to us, you know, our Christianity imbues everything that we do, the way that we look at the world, the kind of lives that we want to live, the values that we hold, the way that we want to educate our children. It's not something that we can put aside while we think about their education and then get out again, you know, maybe at the weekend. And as Sarah says, you know, very often they were going back to biblical edicts to say, you know, and returning to the ideas that in the Eamon Callan quote that I made at the beginning, that if parents being stopped from doing this are actually being denied their own religious freedom, it's not just to do with the education of children, it's also to do with adult people being able to enact their faith. one of the problems that I think arises from this is that it becomes very difficult to categorize what can be in that environment, to categorize what can be seen as an internal restriction, because according to the views held by Penn and others, almost anything that has a faith value to it could be seen as an internal restriction because it's presenting a particular worldview to children. And that could be seen as restricting them because it's not presenting a secular worldview to them. So I think there are real problems there that we need to think about concerning how do we identify whether something is an internal restriction or not. Not least because running alongside that, a lot of the parents were saying to us things like, it's not that we want to shut our children away from the world. It's partly, as Sarah explained, the world doesn't actually want us very much. But it's also because as parents, we feel that we need to be making decisions about when is the right time to introduce our children to particular ideas, things that go on in wider society, the ones that are often quoted and the kind of the hot topic around this in England at the moment, LGBTQ issues and views towards homosexuality and other adult sexualities. And parents saying, you know, we want to be able to pick the time. It's important, not only from the point of view of the child being cognitively, emotionally ready, but also that they have some kind of basis from which they are able to judge, talk about, explore these things. Part of the issue that I have with that is that all parents maybe naturally want to protect their children from certain aspects of society, whether that is sexualization or commercialization or violence or other issues that we might think are adult issues. And that idea of protecting children, where do we cross over into the idea of an internal restriction brought about by a minority group? And where do we see that? How do we see that as protecting children? To go quickly back to Kimlicker's arguments about internal protection, his counterbalances for the minority groups are that there must be the opportunity for individuals within those groups to question, reject or explore doctrines, and to exit from the group if that's what they want to do. And talking to the Christian parents, we found that that was very much at the forefront of many of their expressed ideas about this, that having a faith is not about sort of going through the motions because that's what your family does. It's about understanding what you believe, why you believe it, why you do the things that you do. And parents found that was integral to their idea of bringing up a child in a faith. So it was clear from that there were the possibilities of heresy, apostasy, exploring, rejecting, taking in part, finding a different faith or no faith at all. They were kind of inherent in parents' ideas about religious education. But just because they were there does not mean that they are guaranteed. One of the things about exploring home education, maybe Christian education in particular, is that it's not homogenous. And just because the possibility is there doesn't mean that it can be guaranteed in any way, any other time. So I think we're just about out of time now, but we do have some questions for you that we thought that we would end at, things that we are still thinking about. And so I've got them there. And hopefully it would be really interesting to hear what you make of those and your thoughts on them. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sarah and Harriet, for your presentation. I want to open the room to comments and questions. There's already one here in the chat by Karen Marie. I'll just read it out loud for all of us. It seems that the broader argument is overly simplistic in that it suggests any specific value not held as normative by the larger society could be construed as an internal restriction, which could be used to support discriminatory status quos like authoritarianism, as well as democratic societies, meaning the broader social political argument, not that of the presenters. So a comment in the chat there. Any other questions or comments that you would like to offer at this time for Sarah and Harriet? There's a hand.
Okay, thank you for your opportunity to me. And I will go deeper again with the presentation from Dr. Harit and Dr. Sarah. I agree with your presentation to use Kim Lee Cha. I'm sorry if my pronoun is not good about Kim Lee Cha. When you elaborate it into the ones of the topic of LGBT, and my question is, I have experience about it in my school because I'm a religious education teacher. And when I have a student is LGBT and told about your experience about it, and there's a full of rejection. And how we, as a religious education teacher, to accept them without rejection. I think it's easy to say, but it is very difficult when we facing the reality of, especially when we have the problem with their parents or their society, how to coming out in the society and how to make LGBT person can be sustained and continue their lives. I think it is important when we use or elaborate about Kim Lee Cha, because as I know that Kim Lee Cha not use LGBT as a subject of a research. When Kim Lee Cha construct the theory of minority and how it works in society. Thank you.
Thank you, Paulus. Harriet or Sarah, would you like to respond?
Yeah, sure. No, that's really interesting. Thank you very much. No, I think you're absolutely right. And, you know, Kim Lee Cha's theory takes very particular examples. And as I said, some of those examples, it's very clear to see where he's going with them. When we start looking at the situation for the Christian home educators in England, some of those lines are much more blurred, as in, you know, well, what counts as an internal restriction? And I think as the question in the chat brings up really nicely as well, is that, yes, this can be used simply as a normative argument. If you are not doing what the mainstream society is doing, that can be treated as an internal restriction. And I think there's, you know, I think there's some hard thinking if we want to proceed with Kim Lee Cha's argument. I think there is some hard thinking around the idea of internal restrictions and what do we do about it. I think the LGBTQ plus issue at the moment is something that is quite prominent in social discussion anyway. Sarah was talking about the politicization of the Christian home educating families and how, you know, they felt that their decision about their children, their faith-based decision about their children, had been somehow politicized. And this is a particular line that I think is picked up in the media about that politicization, that, you know, that this is an intolerant group with right-wing ideas, that they come out in attitudes towards homosexuality, different sexualities, and that's partly where that political pigeonholing comes from. The parents that were responding to us said things like, well, no, actually, you know, we're not like that. We don't hate groups in society. You know, we are informed from a religion of love and acceptance. And because we don't necessarily approve of people's lifestyles or their choices within those lifestyles, that doesn't mean that we don't care about them or that we're not interested in them. And I think it's really interesting, actually, because I think it goes back to the other two presentations that we've heard today about how we handle difference in society. And I think in England we're becoming really bad at it. We're becoming really bad at respecting people who don't think the same as us. And I think, like the question in the chat says, you know, there is a normative push that makes groups like the Christian home educators very vulnerable. Back to Kim Lee Cha's external protections.
Thank you,
Thank you. Dr. Harry. Thank you all. We have the remainder of our time now to address. Just any comments about the whole of this session. So we've got three excellent presentations with a lot of overlap. I'll just name a couple of the themes that I heard, and then I want to invite questions for about the next 12 minutes. And we can begin with what Elizabeth asked earlier as well. I'm hearing themes of both hospitality and dynamics of power between parents and educators, between children, between governments and policies and home education, partnerships and what that looks like between parents and educators, but also across teachers and children, and between children themselves, the power of misunderstanding, and also the power of working with and learning about as it's with the goal of familiarity and hospitality. And reciprocity also is something that I heard across the three presentations. I want to begin with, as promised, Elizabeth's question from the second session, which is about why aren't we helping children learn about human difference, especially religious difference, as from a place of respecting others, from a space of also self-respect, I would say, as well. So is that something that you would like to address, or we can hear some other questions as well?
I wonder if it's something that we haven't, that it seems to be so self-evident that we haven't paid attention to how do we teach respect. Maybe that's a fundamental query that in our contemporary world, global society, where there is so much disrespect, so much violence, so much exploitation, etc., so much. I think as a society, we generally, global, we have become less hospitable. And Australia and its turning back the boats and teaching England and other places to do that is just horrific as far as I'm concerned. So I guess I'm of that ideological understanding that education has a role to play in trying to make our world more respectful globally, caring for one another. Maybe I just come from that 60s ideological concept. I'd like others to talk about it.
Sarah.
I was just going to, on the back of that, Elizabeth, I feel that there's, and as Karen Marie was saying in the chat there's almost this tacit kind of acceptance, but a bit blasé sort of, well, you know, and a lack of critical thinking, you know, and I think just so many, many people are just sort of, you know, oh yeah, well, that's what everyone's saying. So I'll just sort of, you know, go with that. And, you know, the Christian home educators, kind of trying to speak against that, but for their families, but this sense of, you know, well, the government says this, you know, what education is doing this, so I'll, yeah, that must be right then, without that sense of critically thinking, what's my opinion, you know, and for those from a religious persuasion, you know, what is my theological thinking of this issue or this thing, and how therefore should I treat people, how respectful should I be, what does respect look like in this context. It just kind of seems to me that lack of critical thinking generally is kind of really missing, and then the next question is, how do we foster that criticality and critical thinking within society and leading to that respect? That's harder one, I think, but for me, I think that's one of the things that when we teach, you know, HE students, you know, that's what I see so much, this just sort of, oh, well, it must be true because, you know, it's on the TV or whatever it is, you know, so that's just my thoughts.
There's a question, a hand raised, Sola.
Thank you so much, and thank you for the thoughts. Yeah, Well, I'm sorry I didn't catch all the names, but someone talked about hospitality and what the society is doing. And then those who, the presenters also talked about the stance of the parents. Now, if I understood the presenters well, it seems that I didn't really get what you are, what you subscribe to, but I did hear all the parents' views, some of them, why they homeschool their kids and why they do not, why they homeschool their kids and the government bills and all that. But I'm a bit concerned about how the society, like the last but one speaker said, about how the society impacts on the children. Because if the school teachers and the religious leaders are teaching hospitality, and in society they get something different, it becomes a major confusion for the child, depending on the age, of course. And I think that's why some parents felt it's better to just homeschool their kids, protect them, let them get to a point where they have understood some things, and then they can go out into the wider world and make a difference. Because, for instance, you teach a child to be hospitable, and all he sees all around him is hostility. He or she, the child, may not really find it very easy to practice that hospitality where there's hostility all around them. For instance, the question I asked earlier, in some parts in my country, Nigeria, children, they see on their own how parents and loved ones are dragged out of their houses and butchered like animals because of their faith. And then you say, okay, tell your friend who is of another faith, come to my house, come and play. Well, the children have learned to be suspicious because they're not sure what will happen. If people were dragged out of their own houses, from their own rooms, and killed in the society where they trusted people, and then you ask them to go out and be hospitable to those same people, well, even where they have a clear conscience, the person they're trying to show hospitality to may not feel comfortable because the person feels like, oh, this may be a trap. So even the smallest children are growing up with this kind of suspicion. So while we want the children to do the right thing, I think we have a lot to do to deal with the adult populace so that they will leave good examples for the children. I'm not sure I've solved any problem. I guess I've raised more about what society is doing and how it's not helping our children. But I hope I've been able to articulate what I'm trying to think. Thank you.
Thank you, Sola, for that nuance. I think that's a very important nuance to make about context and about how hospitality works or doesn't work in the different historical and present contexts around the world. I wonder if one of our presenters might want to address that.
So I thank you very much for raising that. I mean, that's such an awful situation that I kind of hesitate to try and theorize about it because you know, that's just so awful, Sola, what you've just said. But I suppose one of the things that's coming out from all of this is that we're all of us educating in or thinking about education in highly politicized contexts, and we can't kind of extract ourselves from that. And I suppose in a way, when we're talking about Kimlicka's internal restrictions and what the Christian home educating parents are telling us, you know, about, and I've heard it called in other research, I've heard it called a protective cocoon around children in order to instill them with particular values, maybe like hospitality and respect and acceptance of difference. Because if those values aren't in place within that protective cocoon, they're not going to be learnt in the wider world. And I think some of the parents that we were spoken to saying, you know, we have to put, you know, if you go down the route of Helen Penn and you have a secular education without religious values, and maybe we can, you know, sort of argue, well, what are we going to count as a religion in this context? But if you have that kind of idea of, you know, we will spread everything out in front of you and then choose what you think is right out of those things, that is impossible for a child or for anybody to do if you do not have some kind of underlying values that allow you to make that choice. And I think that that was one of the fundamental things that the Christian home educators were saying they wanted their children at home to do.
Thank you, Harriet. Ina or Heejin, would you like to respond? in the last couple remaining minutes? We maybe have time for one more quick question.
No, I don't
have... Oh, go ahead, Ina.
I don't have a question. I just remain silent and with the concept of hope in my mind. Even if in the most difficult and complex situations, as we know from the Second World War, for example, we must live from hope and we must live in hope. And that's something we have to give our children as well. Next to all kind of dialogicality and whatever, maybe hope is the most important.
Thank you all for this really enlightening conversation and these wonderful presentations and the conversation that happened around them.